What I'm going to introduce today is a use case that I worked with in order to design and to define and deliver a new architectural model that fit the future challenges of UN agencies. The idea of building a new innovative architecture, being able to serve the people, and I mean the citizen, in a better way, comes from the necessity to provide a better quality and a higher quality of the current in place services used and adopted by the agencies, but having in mind to reduce the costs. But in order to the business drivers that act behind the scene and that are meant to be accomplished by this use case are basically three. The first one is the possibility to enable all the entities that are involved in the UN landscape, like beneficiaries, donors, citizens, to access to a new concept of what is. What really is an agency that can be viewed as a continuous flow of information that can be aggregated in a way, in a better way, and that is most valuable and useful for the citizen itself. In the opportunity to manage and to manage services, data, and information in a smart and secure way. And this sets the roadmap for a transformation of what each agency does and how this work is perceived by each citizens. And the last one is that is the possibility to introduce and to unleash the power of an ecosystem where each agency, which services of each agency, and which information provided in, by each agency is exposed as an API. But in order to steer this kind of transformation, is needed to enforce some principle that can be considered the pillars of this transformation. That are the idea. The first one is the idea that each a piece of data is open and everyone is free to use, reuse, and distribute in a way that is most useful and valuable for himself. This brings us to define what it can be said an information-centric approach, where the core of the approach is the information itself, and can introduce the concept of what is an open government that defines administration model in order to consider and to enable a sort of model that gives you a better and a higher quality of the digital services. In addition to that, also the process of moving from a bad habit of having building processes and services as a vertical and bespoke artifacts, moving towards the mindset of having a platform where you can share your processes, your services, and where all this kind of stuff are managed in a consistent and in a standard way. And these two points drive us towards the direction of what we can say is a people-centric approach, because in this way we can serve, we can manage, we can present any kind of information in the way how the citizen wants. And with this, we saw the when the citizen interacts with the government, this interaction is based on who you need, who you are, and what are your needs, and not based on how the organization is, how the government, the agency is organized. This means that it's not the citizen that needs to be adapt to the organization itself, of the agency, but the way how the citizen needs the information and what kind of needs he has is the agency itself that needs to be adapt to this kind of needs. And at last, with the use of a standardized platform, enables you to embrace the principle of security and privacy that ensure you to protect your data. But in order to build this kind of new architecture, it's needed to understand how each agency, how each government public administration works. And what we did is to try to analyze and to find a contact point in each processes that is used by any agency. What we identify basically two kind of process. One, what is the, is named the core processes, that is the blue one, where there are basically six phases that are commonly used by any agency to start any new initiative. And then we have on the bottom part the core the support processes that defines the set of experience of processes or any activities that are in scope to easy and to speed up the core process itself. Going back to the core processes, as we said, we have six phases. The first one that is called initiative management. Here we have the gathering and the collecting of all ideas that are considered as initiative. After that, we have the each agency is in charge to start the fundraising to perform the partners engagement management to qualify any new opportunity for fundraising. After that, we have the setup phase that is where all the information, all the data are acquired, processes analyzed, and then in order to make a plan and to put in place the ready strategy and to assess all the potential benefits that comes from the initiatives. After that, we have the real development of the initiative, and where we all the steps are tracked, monitored in a clear way, and where the agency tends to build a strong relationship with the beneficiaries and the donors of the initiative. After the setup, the setup run, we have the last two phases, where basically what an agency does is to define all metrics, all KPIs that to assess the result and the benefits that are coming out from the initiative. This means that in this way we can have a clear and precise way how to build. What are the main benefits of the initiative, and this can lay the foundation of what we can say the next steps. So basically, what we did is to try to normalize all the processes that are in place currently in each agency, and to define a common way to work and to act for the definition of new initiative and or new projects. From the normalization of the step and the adoption of these processes by all the agency, this drives to the definition of what can be said an agency as a platform, where as a platform of services and a processes, where each citizen is can get a more valuable and more useful information and services that they need. In the last years, a lot of agencies missing out the opportunity to see to on this kind of shared digital space, and this means that can lead to a waste of money and a failure in the consistent application of new approaches and new technologies. But with the idea of having an agency as a platform, is it possible to, whenever there comes a new project, and it's possible to look before creating new infrastructure, new services, and new processes, it's possible to look into this shared area, this shared space, in order to reuse and to create in a better way and in an innovative way, the services that are going to be consumed by the consumer, that are the citizen, and with having in mind the reduction of the cost. But in order to accomplish to this task, what is needed is that each agency needs to externalize their own enterprise asset. This means that they need to allow other agencies to use and to leverage easily their internal asset to create in an aggregated way a broad and new type of services. This is what can be defined an API-driven strategy, where in fact in the last years the APIs are transforming the internet in a different way. What does it mean? This means that internet is becoming is going from a network of web application or web tools, operated and owned by several entities, to an open ecosystem of APIs, where you can create processes, application, and services, and you can share this kind of services as an API. The major benefits that comes from this kind of strategy are, for example, you allow to outsource your part of infrastructure and your application to other agencies that are domain expert. In this way, you can manage in an easily way and a better way, with a safe in cost, your processes. Also, the more you allow to the expert to help you, the more node of networks of this expert you are working with. So this means that you can leverage on a bigger community of experts, and you can use and you can embrace of the asset of the other agencies and the other entities in a better and in a common way. And in addition, moreover, also leveraging on this API ecosystem, where for building your application, gives you the opportunity also to contribute back to these ecosystems in order to build a new seamless application experience to the final customer, that in our case is the citizen. After that, What we did is to define an architecture that is composed basically on three layers. The information layers that can be viewed as a container of all data that has been collected, acquired, analyzed, and this kind of data can be structured data like employment data, or as well as unstructured data like facts, sheet, press releases, or compliance guidance. On top of that, we have the platform layer where are present all the processes, all the common processes, all the web application, all the web APIs that we have identified till now. And then and we have also some IT critical function like resource management, financial management, asset, and so on. And the last one is the presentation layer that this represents how the information and how the services are exposed to the final consumer this represents also how the public and the private sector delivers the information, whether or using the classical channels like web application, web page, or any kind of tools or notification, or through the new multi-channel delivery services. Let's just think about the new trend about the IoT. So the possibility to have the same information available on all devices, and in order to build a more connected and more valuable world. This is what we can say is what we did after that is we define the logical view of the architecture. So this means that this is an agnostic product architecture where we put all the processes, all the components that we have identified in our analysis, starting from the top of the architecture. We have the integration layer where we integrated all the systems, all considering also the legacy systems, to provide in a common way what we call a common data model, that is a unique view of all kind of data that are managed and processed by an agency. And on top of that, we have the process, all the functional processes that we already talked about the conceptual model. And as last layer, we have the API layer, where that is the layer that allows you to expose, to externalize your processes, your function, and your data to the external world. After that, what we did is to try to map each layer and each component of our logical architecture to a technology view. What does it mean? This means that we try to map each layer with a set or one or with a set of products in order to have a complete and overall view of our architecture. As we can see, we have most of the WS2 product that covers the components and the layer of the architecture. And why? Because WS2 is providing open source products, and based on the same idea, what we try is to give an architecture that is open oriented. This means so in this way we can have a complete solution based on an open source products. The main benefits that we notice, we experience from this architecture is to the push on. As already said, on an API approach, the possibility to scale out and scale up, based on the peak, so to have a cloud burst policy in place, the possibility to have a disaster recovery policy in case of failure or any issue, any raising issue that can cause loss of data or an availability of the services. We have a complete decoupled architecture, as each layer expose a set of services, and so is each layer is completely decoupled from the other in order to have a complete decoupled solution. And with this architecture, we have also a unique point of control for the overall architecture. In this way, we can manage the entire architecture in a unique way and in a centralized way. And this, having in mind the first goal of this architecture, can reduce the cost in a very not negligible way.